Hello from the National Football Museum. I'm Jon Sutton, I'm the Exhibitions Manager here, and welcome to our 7th annual Manchester Football Writing Festival. We usually be welcoming visitors to the museum for this week-long festival, but we're doing it online this year instead. The festival stars a host of top writers, and we're excited to share their featured books with you. If you enjoy the talk today, make sure to like, share, subscribe to keep up with the festival. Recently, I caught up with Kieran Maguire about his brilliant book, The Price of Football. You can hear it now.
So, Kieran, most of us support a team, watch the games, don't necessarily think about all the money that's rolling around or isn't rolling around in the game. How did you become aware of this, and how did you become a football finances expert?
Well, I teach accounting at university, and I'd always found that it's difficult to get students to engage because nobody's particularly interested in what I teach as a rule. So if I say, well, something's just happened at Apple or something's just happened at BMW, people are going, I don't really care. As soon as you mention football, ears prick up. And I've taught, I've been teaching since the 80s, and I teach in Manchester and Liverpool, which of course are two big footballing cities. So I sort of used to use football accounts as a bit of a Trojan horse to get students to engage, because if you say to somebody, how have Manchester United bought all of their players over the course of the last 7 or 8 years, they go, we should go out and buy them. You said, well, okay, take a look at this. And then you show them a chart that shows that since Sir Alex Ferguson retired, Manchester United's creditors in terms of football transfers went up from 13 to £258 million. We were going, well, hold on, why doesn't this get mentioned? And I say, so it's a way of showing people how to identify some of the more curious things that arise in the world of finance and football. And the more you dig into it, the more strange that football finance. It is a unique industry because the aim of most companies is purely to make money. And you know, as a football fan, that's not what you go to football for. And we also find out that as far as many club owners are concerned, that's what they're not in it for either. If you look at Roman Abramovich, he's not interested in making a return. If you look at Mashiri at Everton, Mansour at Manchester City. You know, I'm a Brighton Hove Albion fan. We've got our owner, Tony Bloom, who's put in, you know, in excess of £350 million into the club. We think he walks on water. You know, he's an amazing, we love him to bits, but his interest is in the club as a football club, not as a financial institution. So it's looking at that balance between financial common sense, drive for the bottom line, but sporting success. And it's difficult to balance the two. So that's how... That's how I sort of became really interested. And then when the Glazers took over Manchester United, I happened to be teaching at one of their advisors that day, one of the banks. And when the deal was announced, I wasn't aware of this, all of the shutters were put across the windows and four huge bouncers appeared at the front door. And I said, what's going on here then, boys? And they said, well, yeah, we're expecting a few Cockney Reds, because I was teaching in London, a few Cockney Reds to pop down and pay us a bit of a visit, and we don't want to put the windows put out. And on the back of that, BBC phoned up the university to said, can anybody explain what's going on? And the university press office pointed them in my direction, because I was sort of known for trying to convert everything that I taught into football. And so I started doing a few interviews on the back of that, and it sort of gently snowballed. But this year, 2020, things have gone completely out of hand. I've done over 800 media slots this year to date, and we're still in October. So that's the history. It was purely by accident. I just happened to be a football fan, and living most of my life in Manchester, supporting Brighton Hove Albion. It was always a long train journey to go to home matches. So I just started building up a spreadsheet of football club accounts, because there was nothing better to do on the journey.
What was the first club you looked at and get and thought, something's not quite right here?
I think sort of in recent times, some of the high profile ones have been Derby County and Sheffield Wednesday. But going back a few years before that, and I know you are a Blackpool fan, was looking at Blackpool's accounts in the year in which they were in the Premier League. And when you go to the small print, you see that somebody at board level has taken out £11 million. And go, well, that wasn't what I quite was expecting, because the rest of the finances looked really good. And the wage bill was ridiculously low for everybody else apart
from... I think there was a wage cap of £10,000. So on the surface, it's like, oh, Blackpool are socialists. You know, they've got morals. They're not paying agents' fees, all this kind of thing. But then at the same time, like you say, £11 million to one-off payment.
I then just started to build up. You know, we were quite fortunate that in around about, I think, about 2008, 2009, the government changed the rules for getting hold of football, well, any business accounts. It previously, you used to have to pay at company's house, but the rules were changed and you could now get them for free. And I'd been following the go-to guy. I mean, everybody's heard of the Swiss Ramble, Kieran O'Connor, and he's the governor, as far as I'm concerned. The guy's an absolute genius. So I've been following him on Twitter and reading his blog, and then he stopped doing his blog. So I thought, well, there's a bit of a vacuum there. I'll start just writing nonsense, you know, nowhere as detailed or as forensic as the Rambles, and build up sort of a portfolio of club accounts to try to work out what's happening in the world of football finance.
I imagine it's got bigger and bigger and more time consuming, I suppose, for you, hasn't it, in the last few years?
Yes. Issues such as financial fair play. We've seen what's happened at Manchester City, the size of the broadcasting deals, the amount of money being spent on transfer markets, the weird obsession that people have with footballers' wages. And I just do not get it at all, because when I go to a movie, you know, if I'm watching Toy Story 3, I don't think, well, that's a bad film because Tom Hanks has got paid $30 million for it. It's either a good film or a bad film on its own merits. And for me, it's exactly the same with football. A match is normally good or bad, depending on whether we win or lose. I've never worked out this fixation with footballers' wages, but it gives me an opportunity to look at the numbers to see in a talent-based industry, do they look excessive? Why are they so high in respect of some clubs and not so in others? So trying to identify the story behind the numbers has always sort of been my main focus.
What are some of those red flags that might set the alarm bells off about how your club's being run?
The things I'd be looking out for is, firstly, is the club being proactive? It's legally obliged to send in a set of accounts by a particular date. So if it's constantly late, then, you know, it's a bit like handing in your homework late. The chances are that it's probably not very good homework. So that's one issue. Constantly changing the company name and setting up lots of other companies. And people think I've got Derby County fans think I've got a fixation with the club, but they are they're just a wonderful case study in their own right. So, you know, Derby County Football Club became a company called Sevco, which became Gellor Law, and there were various bits which were being transferred here, there, and everywhere. It's only a football club. It's a simple business to run. You don't really need to do this. So, you know, that's a cause for concern. And then looking for unusual changes in numbers. So if you've got a football club in the first year and you've got 300 employees, and in the second year you've got 200 and you're in the same division, you go, well, that's unusual. You know, how on earth did that happen? And then you start to dig a bit further. If the company is based offshore, you know, the likes of the British Virgin Islands, there's no necessity for a company, you know, for a football club from an English industrial town to have connections with the BVI or the Cayman Islands. So, you know, it just makes you feel slightly uneasy. So there's things of that nature. And then there's what's referred to as related party transactions. Now under UK rules, you've got to set out what those are. So is the owner taking large amounts of money from the club? Are they sponsoring the club through unusual ways? So I was looking at non-league football last night on behalf of somebody. And I was looking at AFC Fylde, and AFC Fylde, very generous local owner, and somebody said to me, "You know, how much are they winning, or how much money are they making?" So, well, yeah, they're losing money. They're losing, I think, around about £8,000 a week. And then I went into the small print, and right on sort of the final page, final sentence was, the owner has sponsored, in addition to supporting the club through being very generous, has also sponsored the club to the tune of £1 million. So they were losing £8,000 a week, and that was after taking into account that £1 million. Without it, you hate to think what the losses were. So there's just a lot of weird and wonderful things taking place.
One of the red flags for me with Blackpool, it wasn't necessarily the £11 million. It was we were playing a game against, I think it was Manchester United, that was meant to be on Boxing Day in the Premier League, and we didn't have undersoil heating, which I think was probably a first in Premier League history, but we had a froze. It was a cold Christmas, and we had to borrow pitch covers from Fleetwood Town, who were in the Conference North. I mean, that must be a first, and that was a sign, perhaps, that and no improvement to the training ground. So there's all these factors, and you just and then we signed James Beattie when he was clearly over the hill as our transfer deadline. The writing was on the wall, and we were. There's been some comments that Blackpool fans weren't complaining when we were in the Premier League, but we were. Right. You know, we were. How on earth is that game being called off? And why are we borrowing pitch covers from Fleetwood?
Yeah, that. If something is weird, if you're in the Premier League, you don't need to operate a pound shop mentality. You don't have to go wild either. There's a happy medium, but that normally indicates that the club is not looking towards a long-term existence in the Premier League. And if you take a look at Blackpool's finances, when they were relegated, they actually did extremely well financially for a few years because they had the benefit of parachute payments and an extremely low wage base. So some people say it was effectively an air shot. Yeah, they were promoted, and the owners simply say, let's pretend we're not promoted and just bank all the money. And then, of course, there were issues between the Oystons and Mr. Bellicon and so on.
We've seen the tragic loss of historic clubs like Bury and Macclesfield. What the big picture thing that was proposed, does that help address the disparity? If not, do you have any suggestions on how we might be able to make it a bit more of a level kind of playing field, or a bit more fairer, or to avoid the loss of more historic clubs?
Project Big Picture was interesting in the sense that on the face of it, it did appear to be a step forward as far as English as football was concerned. As soon as you started to go into the detail, and like many people slightly connected to the game, and I'm not involved in the world of football, a copy of the full document mysteriously appeared in my inbox a few days ago. So I went through it on a line-by-line basis. There are gaps in English football, but Project Big Picture has been in creation for the last 3 or 4 years. So to say that it was a response to COVID is a complete misconception. Project Big Picture came about following Leicester City winning the Premier League in 2016, because the established elite club said that should not be allowed. Now, that's completely wrong. We're entitled to win the trophies, only us. But more importantly, Leicester City have taken away one of our Champions League places. So ever since then, and we saw this in sort of 2017, 2018, when the distribution rules for overseas broadcasting rights were changed to favour the larger clubs. Ever since then, all the decisions which have been made have been to give more money to the likes of Liverpool, Manchester United, Chelsea and so on, and to make it more difficult for the smaller clubs to compete. And Project Big Picture is just the final manifestation of that. You know, why reduce the Premier League in size? Well, the argument put forward is that this is going to help England win the World Cup. And you go, wow, that's really good. And then you find, well, if you get rid of the, cut down the Premier League to 18 teams and get rid of the Carabao Cup, that means that every single weekday, Tuesday and Wednesday, is now free. And all of a sudden, there's talk about the change to the Champions League starting in 2024-25. We know that there's going to be a new format. This now sets up the opportunity to have a 16 or 18 team European Premier League, whatever it's going to call itself. And all of a sudden, instead of England being in a stronger position, you've got 34 league games in the Premier League, potentially another 34 games in the European Super League, and then it goes to a knockout there as well. So, you know, we're talking 70 games before internationals and before the FA Cup. So don't try to insult our intelligence. And that's the thing which aggrieved me most of all, that it was being set up as this incredibly benevolent nature, and you had people going around saying, oh, the Glazers and John Henry, they really care about English football, and that's why they're giving £250 million to EFL clubs and 25% of the Premier League TV deal. Now, you know, the EFL clubs, they're just thinking, this is free money. This sounds great. Then you dig into the detail, and what happens is, of course, the £250 million isn't free money, it's an advance of the TV deal. So it's going to be taken away once that TV deal starts. And then, again, embedded in the small print of Project Big Picture is that Premier League clubs will be able to sell their own TV rights in the international market. Now, if you are Liverpool, which matches are you going to try to sell? Yourself, well, you know, Manchester United, Chelsea, Arsenal, Spurs, Everton, you can imagine. What does that leave the Premier League to sell? Well, it's got West Bromwich Albion versus Burnley. It's got, you know, Crystal Palace versus Southampton. It's got Brighton versus Newcastle. You try selling those on an international market. Presently, the value is worth around about £1.3 billion a year, which is fantastic negotiation by the Premier League. But it's on the basis of, we will sell you every single match. So presently, there's 380 matches. It will be reduced to around about 130. And frankly, they're the matches which even people like yourself and I, John, who are sort of football crazy, we're thinking, can I really be bothered to, you know, anybody that had the misfortune to pay £14.95 to watch Burnley versus West Brom at 5:30 on a Monday, which is a 0-0 draw, must be in a very, very depressed state of mind at present. The EFL, we're getting 25% of the runt of the litter. So, you know, it's everything you went through just seemed too good to be true. And as soon as you sort of lifted the carpet, lots of stuff started to appear from underneath it that had been swept under. Sadly, you know, the majority of those things are going to go through. So 18 club Premier League, I think it's inevitable. Get rid of the Carabao Cup. Realistically, nobody's going to miss it. You know, when was the last time you get excited about a Carabao Cup match? So some of that, but I think the big pushback hopefully will come through in terms of who has power in the game. The idea put forward, you know, and you've got John Henry and Joel Glazer and Rick Parry saying, well, one person, one vote, that's bad. You know, that's good grief. That's far too democratic. I think there will be pushback from government, certainly from fans' organisations, are very much against it. We'll have to wait and see. So at present, I went through a I went through a sort of a list of numbers. If you look at the top six teams, they've got three times the income of the rest of the Premier League's, the other 14. The clubs, the other 14, they generate three times as much revenue as clubs receiving parachute payments, who in turn generate three times the income of the other clubs in the Championship, who in turn generate three times as much revenue as the clubs in League One. So we've got these big, big cliffs. And what Project Big Picture would have done, it would have narrowed some of those gaps, but the gap between the big six and the rest of the Premier League, it wouldn't have been three times, it would have been seven or eight times. And football as we know it, and we all like to think there's an element of romance in football, and there's an element of every club in the Premier League has a chance of beating another. And if you look at the history of the Premier League, that's why it's been so successful. You know, we've seen Crystal Palace win at Old Trafford this season. We've seen Villa, who've only been promoted for 12 months, thrash Liverpool. And that's great. You know, that degree of uncertainty. The irony that those results took place effectively a few days before Glazer and John Henry's plans came to light is indicative of what they want to change. They want walks in the park. They want guaranteed victories. Yeah. So it's a horrid, horrid power grab. It will make the very, very rich very, very richer. Will clubs benefit in the lower leagues? We don't know, because there was nothing in those plans that would have prevented the top six clubs saying, well, we've been so successful selling eight games a season direct to fans, let's make it for the whole division. And now all of a sudden the EFL clubs are getting 25% of absolutely nothing.
One of the great things about it is it's shown like that you can be a supporter of one of those clubs that would benefit, one of the big six, and they're very vocally outspoken against the army, but it's whether what influence they can have on it, I suppose, in terms of going ahead.
Well, unfortunately, we as fans, you know, our voices are very, very small, but they are heard on occasions. And again, we've got the Liverpool owners saying that we understand British football culture. Well, no, Liverpool were the first Premier League club to adopt the furlough scheme. And that was complete. And you know, again, fair play to Liverpool fans to say, you do not represent us. You know, we know that we are a wealthy club. This is completely at odds with the values that we associate with Liverpool Football Club, and the spirit of Shankly, the Anfield Rap, all of those Liverpool fan groups were united, and you've got to give them a lot of credit for making the club realise that they made a horrendous decision purely based on money, and so therefore for the owners to claim that they understand what football is and the football pyramid is in this country is a complete farce.
Going back to the fact that, you know, like with that, you're saying that Liverpool fans think there's a set of values, but obviously their owners might not necessarily be aware or share those supposed values. But the fit and proper test, it definitely does allow for considerable flexibility, doesn't it? But because obviously the Oystons were passing that test every year, etc. But what are the signs that you've actually got a brilliant owner that's doing the best for their club, that's the custodian of your club?
Well, I think, John, you said the right thing there, that the key word is custodian rather than owner. Somebody who sees themselves as trying to create a legacy of shared memories, shared experiences for fans that they can look upon back with pride at a later point in their life. To have an effective and a really good fit and proper test would be a huge challenge, especially under the present system where football regulates itself and decisions are made by club owners. So club owners are not going to vote through anything which makes it more difficult for them to sell the club at a future date. And you can understand that. That self-interest exists in all aspects of life. Let's not pretend that football is this unique institution where everything is done for the right reasons. It's not. But that has resulted in the present form of owners and directors tests being a very, very low bar. Now, therefore, it makes it almost impossible for the EFL. If we take a look at what's happened at Charlton, we take a look at what's happened at Macclesfield, Bury, Bolton, Southend. You know, there's many, many other clubs around where the behaviour of the owners has at times been not particularly positive from a fan's perspective. How do you legislate against that? When those decisions have to be voted on and approved by the club owners themselves. So self-regulation, and I think the Football Association, they summarise this very well. Self-regulation is not a right, it's a privilege. And you've got to prove that you're entitled to that privilege. The actions of club owners, or too many club owners, sadly, in recent years, suggests that they cannot be trusted as a collective. On an individual basis, there's brilliant club owners. You know, Mark and Nicola Palios at Tranmere, Andy Holt at Accrington Stanley. We've got the people at clubs such as Lincoln and Shrewsbury and so on, you know, done fantastic things on a small scale. Yeah, they don't get the glory. So perhaps to have some form of independent body, an independent regulator, that there are things that you can do. If when you bought a football club, if you take a look at industries such as travel and hotels and tourism, you have to put down a bond. So if you want to be a travel agent, you have to put money in effectively insurance policy. So if you go bust, then the insurance policy effectively covers the losses, and you don't get your money back when you sell the club until the authorities are happy that all the transactions have been of an appropriate nature. So we could have some form of financial investment into a collective fund when you buy a club. It will make it, of course, more difficult to buy the club, but it will stop people such as Steve Dale buying a football club for a pound.
Yeah, I mean that's a big enough clue, isn't it? If you can buy a football club for a pound, what's good? What's around the corner?
So all you're doing that is you're just buying the right to use the name. So that would be one thing. At present, football clubs are run as private fiefdoms, and the football owner is the squire. And effectively what the squire does goes through. Well, why not say every time that there is a change of ownership at a football club that the football regulator has the right to appoint two or three non-executive directors who can therefore monitor. And that's for a period of, let's say, 3 years. And if they are satisfied with the behaviour of the new owner, then they can walk away, or then we can reduce it to one non-executive director. And that way, the incentive for the rogues and scoundrels and miscreants that we've seen at the likes of Bury and Charlton and Macclesfield and so on, if they know that they're going to buy into a football club which is subject to independent scrutiny and monitoring, then there's less opportunity for them to do the things which they might end up doing. And it becomes a less seductive industry from which to make money. So those would be a couple of suggestions. If I was a present owner of a club, would I vote for those? I'd need quite a lot of persuasion. What's in it for me? Yeah, there's nothing in it for me. We've seen the likes of Gary Neville and the Football Supporters Association and others come forward with some form of NFL-style commissioner of football. Doesn't always work, but we have Ofwat for the water industry. We have Ofcom for the communications industry. What's wrong with Offoot for the football industry? To try to acknowledge that football is more than a business, it's more than a game, it's a sense of identity and belonging for individual towns and cities, and it does give you those unique memories and experiences.
I was going to ask about whether the COVID, I mean, it probably isn't really, but the COVID-19, whether that pandemic is going to make it more of a level playing field, but obviously, if you've got things like European breakaway leagues, it's how much of a level playing field can it be?
That's, I mean, the European Premier League is just opportunism on the back of COVID-19. Crisis creates opportunity. It's one of the things we say on my MBA course. Just because there's a disaster happening in the world, it's not a disaster for everybody. And what we have seen is some of these proposals, which will be dressed up to be a benevolent act of altruism by individuals, tends to be exactly the opposite.
Yeah. So is it more a level playing field for almost like fallen giants like Sunderland, who are going to be at the wrong end of it, lower down the divisions, if you know what I mean, in terms of these, for example, there's a few players that I think they had as targets that they've had to pull out, and other teams in that division that have been able to snap them up.
Well, I think that's due to the fact that in League One, we now have a squad salary cap. So that's probably a separate issue to COVID itself. If you are a fallen giant, Project Big Picture is terrible news, because it's going to be harder to get back into the Premier League, because instead of having three clubs being promoted, there are now two clubs being promoted, and then the playoffs are between one club who finishes third from bottom in the Premier League, who's likely to be, having seen my club transform itself from Championship to Premier League, the step up is significant. So you would expect the club finishing third bottom from the Premier League to maintain its place six times out of 10, at least. In that, I think that's a fair assessment. So it's going to be harder for clubs to get promoted to the Premier League. And once there, the first thing that happens under Project Big Picture is they take £25 million away from you, and they say, we'll give that to you when you get relegated. So it's not officially a parachute payment, but by gum, it looks like one. So you've got a smaller... You've got a smaller budget when you get promoted, so you're more likely to be relegated. You're playing fewer fixtures, so therefore there's less money coming in, and all the money, of course, is going to the people in the European Premier League. It's a lot for clubs such as Sunderland, Forest, Derby, Wednesday, who, you know, there's no doubting that these clubs have big support and have parts of the history and the heritage of English football. It's going to make it an even tough task, even tougher.
And then the benefits to England team is irrelevant, because you're going to have players burnt out. Yeah. You're going to have players not playing enough football. So there's going to be this huge void.
I mean, when I read that, I said, my reaction was, you are patronising us. You are taking us, and there is this genuine feeling, I think within the upper echelons of club ownership, not all clubs, that Give them a new away kit and they'll talk about that, and they won't be interested in things of this nature. We're not as stupid as people perhaps make out, and we've seen that mentality come not from just club owners, but also from central government with the refusal to allow fans to attend matches, even though in terms of transmission of COVID, the risks are lower. No football fans are asking for a full return at present, but the lunacy that I can go to a match in the Premier League in the hospitality suite and watch it on a big screen with the blinds pulled down, you trying to tell me that makes sense?
Yeah, because I'm a Blackpool season ticket holder, but I didn't renew within the it was the first 1,000 that renewed that could go, so I didn't go to it, but it looked very, very safe. Yeah. And then suddenly that's taken, and there was no issues at all, and suddenly it's taken away. Just seems absolutely crazy, really.
Yeah. And what's the capacity at Bloomfield Road?
17,000.
And your average crowd?
9, something like that. Right.
So if they said, well, we'll keep it at 30%, then that's, you know, 5,500 can come in.
Yeah, exactly. You'd
say, well, no away fans, probably. So practically, you know, every Blackpool season ticket holder could have seen every match this season.
Yeah, it would have been, I think it's about 5,000-6,000 season ticket holders. So yeah, like you say, we could have gone to every game, and I would have felt much safer than watching it in the hospitality lounge. Kieran, I think that's pretty much everything. So, cool. The book's a real labour of love. It's hefty. It's Hold on, it's got everything in there, hasn't it?
It went through two complete rewrites.
Any follow-up books on the horizon?
I'm actually almost finished the second edition of the book. So I've added a chapter to about COVID, updated all the stats for 2019. A few more digs at Sheffield Wednesday and Derby County.
Great stuff there from Kieran. His book is really recommended. A huge thanks for joining us for this special Manchester Football Writing Festival talk from the National Football Museum. We have a full week of author Q&As, so check those out on our channel too. To find out more information about the festival and the museum, go to nationalfootballmuseum.com. Thanks for watching. See you again soon.